Hello everyone, I am Sweetie from SV Classes. Today I will explain you chapter number 2, Long Walk of Freedom, written by Nelson Mandela. It is an extract taken from the autobiography of Nelson Mandela and it is in your book First Flight, class 10. These are the lines told by Nelson Mandela. It always seems impossible until it is done. From this line itself, you would be able to understand that he is quite an optimistic person who is full of hope and positivity. So let us read the chapter and try to understand more about this great person. So before going through the chapter, let us go through the biography of Nelson Mandela so that you would be able to understand the chapter more clearly. So he was born in Madiba. It is a village in Eastern Cape, and he was born on 18th July 1918. When he was just 12 years old, his father died. He attended primary school where his teacher, Miss Medgain, gave him the name Nelson, because during that time there was a custom that the students who used to go to primary school, they were Christianized, they were given another Christian name. So he was given name Nelson by his teacher. He joined the African National Congress in the year 1944. During his birth, during his childhood, South Africa was under the power of the whites. He was imprisoned in 1962. On 11th June 1964, Mandela was sentenced to life imprisonment and sent to Robben Island. This is the island where he was kept as a prisoner. And in 1993, he became the president. He and President F.W. Clark jointly won the Nobel Peace Prize. So they also were being awarded by Nobel Peace Prize. And in the year 1992, in April 27, he voted for the first time in his life. And on 10th May 1994, he was inaugurated as South Africa's first democratically elected president. And finally, he died at the on 5th December 2013. So this is the biography of Nelson Mandela. You can see that when he was born, South Africa was under the power of the whites. And one another thing, that he was born in a royal family. It was a rich family. But then afterwards, as he became youth, he found that he should fight for the freedom of the blacks. And that's why he joined the African National Congress in 1942. He went to jail for almost 27 years. And finally, for the first time, he voted in the year 1994. And then in the year 1994, he became the first president. So in this chapter, we are going to read about all these details in further. These are some words told by Nelson Mandela. I have fought against white domination. I have also fought against black domination. I have cherished the ideal of a democratic and free society in which all persons live together in harmony and with equal opportunities. It is an ideal which I hope to live for and to achieve. But if needs be, it is an ideal for which I am prepared to die. From these lines, you would be able to understand that he was in the favor of harmony. There should be harmony, peace in the society. He fought against the white domination and the black domination both. And what was his final hope? That people should live in peace, and that he, for that achievement, if he had to give himself, then also he was ready. So he was a great person. Let us study more about him. So in this chapter, you are going to understand about the description of the inauguration ceremony. It was in the year 1994 when the first time a black people became a black man became the president of South Africa. So it was Nelson Mandela. So we are going to see some parts of the inauguration ceremony, then some citations from his speech. Citations means some extract, the words, the sentence that were told by Nelson Mandela, the same we are going to see in the chapter and try to understand it. Next, we are going to understand in this chapter his journey to begin a freedom fighter. So we are also going to see his past, that as a boy, as a child, and as a youth, how he struggled and how he became a freedom fighter. And in the speech, he gives tribute to other freedom fighters and countless other people who fought for their freedom. So these are the points that are been included in the chapter. So let us read the chapter line by line. Mandela becomes South Africa's first black president. These three paragraphs are in the starting of the chapter. It just gives a detail that almost for three centuries, the whites ruled on South Africa. Three centuries means almost for 300 years. And Nelson Mandela, who was from the African National Congress, they had election in 1994. And the party won 252 out of 400 seats. And in this first democratic elections of South Africa, there was an inauguration ceremony that took place in the Union Buildings amphitheater. And during that ceremony, many politicians and dignitaries were attended that ceremony, almost of 140 countries. And these are the lines told by Nelson Mandela: never, never again will this beautiful land experience the oppression of one by another. So what he wanted, he want harmony, peace in the country. And that's why he told that this soil or this land will never, never again experience any oppression of any one person to another. So it was a great scenario to see that all the people, almost 1 lakh South African men, women, and everybody, and of different colors and of all races, were present in that ceremony. And Nelson Mandela gave a very inspiring speech on that particular day. So here begins the chapter. Now let us read and then understand the difficult words and explanation. 10th May dawned bright and clear. For the past few days, I had been pleasantly besieged by dignitaries and world leaders who were coming to pay their respects before the inauguration. The inauguration would be the largest gathering ever of international leaders on South African soil. Dawn. What is the meaning of dawn? It means a beginning of a day. The opposite of dawn is dusk. Pleasantry means happy satisfaction. Besieged, to be surrounded by. So here Nelson Mandela was surrounded by the dignitaries and the world leaders who were coming and paying their respect before the inauguration. So 10th May 1994, it was the day when Nelson Mandela was being elected or was taking an oath as the president of South Africa. So on this day, many dignitaries and many world leaders came, and even before the day, for the past few days, many dignitaries are coming to South Africa and they are paying their respect, their well wishes to South Africa. And the inauguration would be the largest gathering, and it was being predicted that this inauguration is going to be the largest gathering where many international leaders are going to gather on the South African soil. And that is why the author is referring the day as bright and clear. You can see this. This is an amphitheater. Amphitheater, it is a place where there is no roof, open space for the sitting arrangement. The ceremonies took place in the lovely sandstone amphitheater formed by the Union Buildings of Pretoria. For decades, this had been the seat of white supremacy, and now it was the site of rainbow gathering of different colors and nations for the installation of South Africa's first democratic non-racial government. So this ceremony took, where it took place in the sandstone amphitheater, which was formed by the union buildings of Petroi. So you have seen in the picture that it is an open space, open air theater where there is a sitting arrangement, and people came over there, they have been arranged over there. And for decades, for many decades, this was the seat of white supremacy. White supremacy means it was being governed by the white people. But now here there are the rainbow gathering. What is the meaning of rainbow gathering? It means that people from all caste and races are present here, and that's why it is said it is a rainbow gathering of different colors and nations, because already more than 140 peoples from different countries, they are gathered over here. And why they are gathered? For the installation of Africa's first democratic non-racial government. On that lovely autumn day, I was accompanied by my daughter Jinani. On the podium, Mr. de Klerk was first sworn in as second deputy president. Then Thabo Mbeki was sworn in as first deputy president. When it was my turn, I pledged to obey and uphold the constitution and to devote myself to the well-being of the republic and its people. So here the author says that on that lovely autumn day, it was the month of May, but South Africa, as it is in the southern part, so there is a opposite season. In the month of May, it is autumn. And that's why it is said that it was the autumn day, and the author was being accompanied by his daughter, Jinani. Here you can see the picture over here. So he was being accompanied by his daughter on this big day. And first, who took the swan? First, the swan was taken by the deputy president and then by the first deputy president. Okay. So two of them had taken the oath, and then it was the turn of Nelson Mandela. And what he committed, he committed that to respect, protect and abide the constitution and to devote his entire life, entire self into the well-being of the republic and its people. So he committed himself that from now onwards, he will obey, he will respect, he will abide the rules of the constitution and devote his life for the welfare of the people. So it was the inauguration ceremony. You can see the pic over here. To the assembled guest and the watching world, I said, today all of us do, by our presence here, confer glory and hope to newborn liberty. Out of the experience of an extraordinary human disaster that lasted too long, must be born a society of which all humanity will be proud. You have to understand each and every word of Nelson Mandela because it means a lot. So to the assembled people, assemble means a gathering. In school also you have assembly in the early morning. So assemble, it is a verb, to assemble means to gather. So it was a gathering together in one place. So to the assembled guest and the watching world, he said, today all of us do by our presence. So the author here wants to mention that we are here present and was giving rise to the hope of, and we should give rise to the hope of a new beginning. Previous rulers, what they have done, they have discriminated and lasted for long. But the one who is now given the opportunity, so who is given the opportunity? The African National Congress is now given the opportunity, and now they will stand against this discrimination. And he is really glad to host this ceremony. And that's why he is telling that this extraordinary human disaster, which the people have experienced for 300 years, but now they are going to they are going to see a new society where humanity will be given the priority, and even the humanity and the people would be proud to see a new nation. We who were outlaws not so long ago have today been given the rare privilege to be host to the nations of the world on our own soil. We thank all of our distinguished international guests for having come to take possession with the people of our country of what is, after all, a common victory for justice, for peace, and for human dignity. So again, he says that there was a time when South Africa was practicing practicing apartheid. We will understand the word apartheid further. So it was a time now that people would enjoy freedom. And finally, they have come to power and they have pledged to make everyone proud. Okay, so what Nelson Mandela is saying, that we will make everyone proud. And he thanked everyone, especially the international leaders. He is thanking all the international leaders and saying that for joining them in the celebrating, and which is the step towards the equal society where every human being will be treated with fairly, with peace, justice, and human dignity. We have at last achieved our political emancipation. We pledge ourselves to liberate all our people from the continuing bondage of poverty, deprivation, suffering, gender, and other discrimination. Never, never, and never again shall it be that this beautiful land will again experience the oppression of one by another. The sun shall never set on so gloriously a human achievement. Let freedom reign. God bless Africa. Here the difficult word is emancipation. Emancipation means the fact of the process of being set free from legal, social, or political restrictions. So this was a political emancipation. It was that now the people are free. They are living in a democratic country. To liberate means to free, to release. Bondage means a stage of being a slave. To discriminate means to unfavor somebody and to favor somebody. Oppression means a prolonged, cruel, or unjustice treatment. And reign means rule, to govern. So here in this line, it is mentioned that after great struggle, they have finally achieved political freedom, political emancipation. So after a great struggle, finally the South Africans have achieved the political freedom. And his government promised to free everyone of the still existing poverty and hardship. So whatever poverty, hardship is there in the country, so this new government is promising that they will make the people free of that. And he then exclaims that freedom should rule. Freedom should reign. Means freedom should rule, and may God shower his blessings on this land. That's why he said, God bless Africa. Okay, this is one of the extract that was asked in 2019. So here is the paragraph given, and from this paragraph the questions are given. You have to answer it. The first question is, who does the pronoun we refer to in the first line of the passage? You can do one thing, you can pause the video and try to find the answer by yourself and then go for the answers. So the first is, to whom we is referred in the paragraph. Here we can see we who were. So who, for whom the we is used? Yes, the we is used for the people of South Africa who were suffering from slavery. What did we achieve at last? So finally, what did the South Africans achieve at the last? They achieved the political emancipation, political freedom. So what will be the answer? We achieved political emancipation, freedom, justice, peace, human dignity for all the people. What is the meaning of bondage in the passage? Bondage means slavery, oppression, domination, exploitation, enslavement. All these meanings are equal to bondage. And what have we pledged? Means what oath they have taken, what commitment they have made. Yes, they have made the commitment to liberation for slavery, freedom from poverty, and the deprivation, sufferings, gender, and other discrimination. So this extract was asked in 2019 paper. Now let us move forward to the chapter. In this paragraph, we are going to understand that how the military force also saluted the new government. So let us read and understand. A few moments later, we all lifted our eyes. Who are we? The people who were present in that inauguration. They all lifted their eyes just after a few moments. And what was the reason? They raised their eyes in amazement. In awe means amazement. As a spectacular. And what they were watching? They were watching the array of South African jets, helicopters, and troop carriers roar in perfect formation over the Union buildings. You can see the picture over here. So in this way, a presentation was being made by the military power. And what they were trying to show, the military power was trying to show that they are now loyal to the new government. It was not only a dismay of pinpoint procession and military force. Means this type of presentation, it was not only a display of the military force to show that how strong they are, but it was also a demonstration of a military's loyalty to the democracy and to the new government that had been fairly and freely elected. So the military power is showing their loyalty, that now they would be loyal to the new government. Now this point, student, it is very necessary to understand that the new government is made by the blacks. And the military forces, it may be possible in that the officers may be whites. But now this white officers or whosoever are the officers, they are now loyal to the new government. Only moments before, the highest generals of the South African Defence Force and police, their chest bedecked with ribbons and medals from days gone by, saluted me and pledged their loyalty. Okay, now here Nelson Mandela is saying that just a few days before, the same officers of the defense force who are being beckoned, who are being shown by many badges and ribbons and medals they are having, they are very well powered. They were undoubtedly, they would have arrested me. What Nelson Mandela wants to say, I was not unmindful of the fact that not so many years before they would have saluted, but they would have arrested me. Means this, they were the same officers who arrested me, and they were the same people who kept me for prison for almost 27 years. But now when we are going to install a new government, the same officers, the same military force, the same military people who are being showered by so many medals, they are saluting me and they are paying their respect to me. Finally, a chevron means a V shape of Ambulance jets left a smoke trail of the black, red, green, blue, and gold of the new South African flag. So there was also the inauguration of the new South African flag. You can see the picture over here, and the jet aeroplanes, and they also showed the same colors in the sky, the color of black, red, green, blue, and gold. So in this paragraph, we are able to understand that how the military force also respected the new government. This paragraph tells us about the national anthem, that the national anthem was a combination of both the whites and blacks. The day was symbolized for me by the playing of our two national anthems. So on that day, two national anthems were sung. One was the vision of the whites, and the next was by the blacks. So two national anthems were sung, and although that day neither groups knew the lyrics of the anthem, they once despised. Despise means hated. Means when the black the national anthem of the blacks was being sung, the whites didn't know the words. They didn't knew the lyrics, means they didn't knew the words of that national anthem. But still, because why? Because they hated them. Once they were hating them, but they would soon know the words by heart. So this line shows that Nelson Mandela was quite optimistic that in the future the whites and black will combinedly will live with a harmony in this new country, in a new democratic country. Means they would not have hatred for each other. And that was the very reason that two national anthems were sung on that day, one of the whites and one of the black. At present also, the national anthem of South Africa has the combination of both. So this is something very inspiring and something message, a strong message given to the world by Nelson Mandela, that after the fight, they do not have any grievances for the whites. On the day of inauguration, I was overwhelmed with the sense of history. Now he just remembers something about the past. And on that day, he was being strongly emotional because he was just remembering something about the past. So what he remembered, in the first decade of the 20th century, 20th century means 1910. So during that day, a few years after the bitter Anglo war was there, and before my own birth, the white-skinned peoples of South Africa patched up their differences and erected a system of racial domination against the dark-skinned people of their own world. So here he wants to tell that for last 300 years, the whites are ruling over the blacks and they have developed a system of apartheid. We are going to know about it further. Apartheid was a system where many places were restricted for the blacks on the basis of their color, their caste. So here that is called a racial domination. So here the writer wants to say that when he was born in a atmosphere, in a scenario where the blacks were being discriminated by a system. The structure they created formed the basis of one of the harshest, most inhuman societies the world has ever known. So he wants to say the cruelty, the brutal things that the whites have done over the black was something very much inhuman. It was something that the world will ever remember it as a bad, as a nightmare. Now, in the last decade of the 20th century, the inauguration was done in the year 1994. It means the last decade of the 20th century. And Nelson Mandela was born in the first decade of the 20th century. So what he is saying that in this last decade of my own 80 decades, means he was also around about 80 years old, that system had been overturned. So that system of apartheid had now been overturned. It has been reversed forever and replaced by one that recognized the rights and freedoms of all peoples regardless of the color of their skin. So now the new system is going to be applied, and in that system, the whites and blacks and all color people are going to get equal rights and freedom. That day had come about through the unimaginable sacrifices of thousands of my people, people whose sufferings and courage can never be counted or repaid. So in this line, he remembers about the sacrifices that were done by the people for the freedom fight, for the freedom of the country. And he remembers all of them, that it is unimaginable sacrifice that was been done by thousands of people, thousands of men and women. I felt that day as I have on so many other days, that I was simply the sum of those African patriots who had gone before me. And here it shows the humbleness of Nelson Mandela. What he is saying, that I am not the only leader who fought for this freedom fight. There were thousands of people who had fought for this, and I am just the sum of all. That long and noble line ended and now begin again with me. So what he is saying, that harsh days, that difficult days are now ended and a new line is going to start. And I was pained that I was not able to thank them and that they were not able to see what their sacrifices had wrought. So what their sacrifices have brought, he is just very thinking that it is quite painful that I am not able to thank all those freedom fighters, because they are not present. They became the martyrs, and they are not able to see that their sacrifices have brought something positive to the country. The policy of apartheid means the policy or system of segregation on grounds of races. So this was been developed by the whites. So the policy of apartheid created a deep and lasting wound in my country and my people. Now, for 300 years, if this type of discrimination was been done by the whites, so naturally it would have created a very everlasting wound in the country and in the mind of the people. And all of us will spend many years, if not generations, recovering from that profound hurt. And he definitely says that it will take time to recover from all this thing. But the decades of oppression and brutality had another unintended effect, and that was that it produced the... So here he is trying to remember all the great people who sacrificed their life for the freedom of South Africa. So what he is saying that this decades of oppression and brutality which was been done by the whites have its very cruel effect. But another thing, they have also produced many good peoples. And who are those good peoples? Like Oliver Tambo, Walter Sisulu, the Chief Luthuli, Yusuf Debus, Bram Fiskars, Robert Sobukwe, and of all our times. So here you can see the picture of all these great people, men of such extraordinary courage, wisdom, and generosity. So this all people had extraordinary courage, wisdom, wise, and generosity, that their like may never be known again. And he just says that such type of people will never be again in this world. Perhaps it requires such depth of oppression to create such heights of character. So this line is totally dedicated to this great freedom fighters. He says that such heights of character cannot be developed by each and every person. And my country is rich in the minerals and gems that lies beneath its soil. But I have always known that its greatest wealth lies in the people, its finer and truth are the pure diamonds. So in this line, he wants to say that although South Africa is rich in natural resources, it has many minerals and gems, but the real diamond is the people. The greatest wealth is the people who are fine and who are true. So in this paragraph, he is trying to remember the freedom fighters, and he praises the people of South Africa. It is from this comrades in the struggle that I learned the meaning of courage. So what he is saying, it is all because of this great people. I lived with them and I have learned the meaning of courage. And in the further lines, he is trying to describe the word courage. Time and again, I have seen men and women risk and give their lives for an idea. So what he says that I have seen a long life and I have seen the people who gave their life, who sacrificed their life for their own idea, for their own ideology. I have seen men stand up to attacks or torture without breaking, showing a strength and resilience that defines the imagination. Resilience means the ability to deal with any kinds of hardship and recover from its effect. So what he is saying that I have seen people who had a great character of tolerance. They used to be tortured, but they had the character of tolerance, and due to that, they were able to stand firm. So from all this sacrifice, from all these people, he has been inspired, and he says that what is the meaning of courage? I learned that courage was not the absence of fear. So courage, it doesn't mean the absence of fear, but when you are able to have a victory over it, when you are able to overcome the fear, it is called courage. The brave man is not he who does not feel afraid, but he who conquers that fear. So what he says, the brave man is not the one who feels afraid, but he who conquers the fear. No one is born hating another person because of the color of his skin or his background or his religion. So in this paragraph, he wants to say that people are very naturally taught the things. So no one is taught of hating another people only because of the color and the background or the religion. People must learn to hate, and if they can learn to hate, they can be taught to love. So what he wants to say that if you can teach a person how to hate, similarly you can also teach a person how to love. For love comes more naturally to the human heart than its opposites. Even then is opposite, what in this line he wants to say, that you can make somebody love things rather than hate the things. Even in the glimmest is very serious times in prison. So in this line he is trying to illustrate his own example, that when he was in prison and when his comrades and he himself was being pushed to our limits, means they were being tortured very much, I would see a glimmer of humanity in one of the guards. The guards means the white people. Means what he told, that even they tortured me and my friends, my fellow people in the prisons, even in those times he was able to see humanity in the eyes of the guards, and perhaps just for a second, but it was enough to reassure me and keep me going. And that single glimpse had made him strong, saying that, or feeling him that good is going to be a flame. So man's goodness is a flame that can be hidden but not extinguished. So what he says, that that little glimpse in the of humanity in that guard have given had strengthened my faith. And what he says, man's goodness is a flame that can be hidden. It is just like a flame which can be hidden for some time, but it can never be extinguished. Extinguished means it cannot end. For some period of time, you can just hide the goodness of a man. You can see that the man is growing bad, but innerly the man is a very good person, and that will naturally come out one day. So this lines tell that Nelson Mandela had full faith in humanity, in goodness. In life, every man has twin obligations. What is the meaning of obligations? Duty. So he says in a life, in a very general life, a simple life, a man has two obligations. One is the obligation to his family, to his parents, to his wife and children. And he has an obligation to his people, his community, his country. So he says that a man has two types of duty. One is towards his family, society, wife, parents. And second is towards his country, community. So each, in a civil and humane society, each man is able to fulfill those obligations according to his own inclination and ability. And every person tries to fulfill both this duty, to commit this duty in a very proper way. But in a country like South Africa, it was almost impossible for a man of my birth and color to fulfill both of this obligation. Now, he's just comparing the condition of the South African peoples with the people of other countries. He says that normally in other countries, two types of duties have been fulfilled by the people and they are able to fulfill it in a proper way. But it was not the case in South Africa. In South Africa, man of color was who attended to live as a human being was punished and isolated. So what he said, in South Africa, if a man want to live a simple, normal life, he was being isolated, he was being punished. In South Africa, a man who tried to fulfill his duty to his people was inevitably ripped from his family and his home and was forced to live in a life apart, a twilight existing of secrecy and rebellion. So when if he rebels or he just go against the government, he was being taken away from his family and was forced to live in some isolated place. I did not in the beginning choose to place my people above my family, but in attempting to serve my people, I found that I was prevented from fulfilling my obligation as a son, brother, father, and a husband. So what Nelson Mandela is saying, that when I started fighting for the freedom of the people, I had to be away from the family and I was not able to fulfill the duty. I was not able to fulfill my obligation, my duty as a son, brother, father, and husband. So here he wants to say, he is somewhat sad to say that he had to sacrifice his family life and he was not able to become a good son, brother, father or a husband. I was not born with a hunger to be free. So here he wants to say, I was not born with a hunger because he was born in a rich family, a royal family. So he didn't have any hunger for free. Means that time he was very happy. He was unable to understand about the outer situation. I was born free, free in every way that I could know, free to run in the fields near my mother's hut, free to swim in the clear stream that ran through my village, free to roast millets under the stars and ride the broad backs of slow moving bulls. So he used to run after the bulls, he used to run in the village, he used to run in the streams, he used to swim in the streams. So he had a very normal life, a village life, and he was very happy when he was a small boy. As long as I obeyed my father and abided by the customs of my tribe, whatever rules and regulations were being told for my tribe. So as long as I obeyed that custom and I obeyed my father, the things were very normal to me. I was not troubled by the laws of the man or God. So it was quite normal to me until I just obeyed my father and the rules of my tribes. It was only when I began to learn that my boyhood freedom was an illusion. Illusion means a false idea. But slowly as he was growing, he understood that all these things was just an illusion. It was just a false idea. When I discovered as a young man that my freedom had already been taken from me, that I began to hunger for it. So as and as he was growing big, he realized that he didn't have the freedom of life. He was unable to go after evening, after 8 o'clock. There were many restrictions for the blacks. And all these restrictions made him believe that he was not living a free human life. At first, as a student, I wanted freedom only for myself. The transitory freedoms of being able to stay out at night, read what I pleased and go where I choose. So as a student, he had very limited things. He wanted to do very limited things, or he want freedom in some limited things only. So what were they? He just want freedom for himself. He want the freedom to stay outside at night. He want freedom to go anywhere and to read whatever he want. But later, as a young man in Johannesburg, I yelled for the basic and honorable freedoms of achieving my potential, of earning my keep, of marrying, of having a family, the freedom not to be obstructed in the lawful life. So, but as he grew as a young man, he realized that the basic needs are not being given to me. The basic freedom which I should be given about marriage, about family life, that are being restricted by the lawful life. So I am a black man, he was being restricted by many laws. So slowly he realized the system of apartheid. But then I slowly saw that not only was I not free, but my brothers and sisters were not free. So slowly he understood that the things that happened to me was not only on me, but also it was the same for my brothers and sisters. I saw that it was not just my freedom that I was curtailed, that I was restricted, but the freedom of everyone who looked like I had, means the same, the all black people. That is when I joined the African National Congress, and that is when the hunger for my own freedom began, the greater hunger for the freedom of my people. So here it starts the journey of Nelson Mandela for the political rights. So his hunger was not only for himself, for his own freedom, but now it was the hunger for the freedom of all the peoples of South Africa. It was this desire for the freedom of my people to live their lives with dignity and self-respect that animated my life. So that changed his life, because he want dignity and self-respect for the South Africans. That transformed a frightened young man into a bold one. Here he tells that first I was a frightened young man, but then afterwards I became a bold one. That drove a law abiding. I was law abiding, means I used to follow all the law, and from that I became a criminal. First, I was a family loving husband into a man without a home, and then afterwards I was forced to live a life loving man to live like a monk, like a saint. I started living like a saint. So I am more virtuous or self-sacrificing than the next man. So what he says, I am more virtuous. Virtuous means having or showing high moral standards, or self-sacrificing than the next man. But I found that I could not even enjoy the poor and limited freedoms I was allowed when I knew my people were not free. Freedom is indivisible. The chains on anyone of my people were the chains on all of them. The chains on all my people were the chains on me. So in this line, he want to say that he urged for the freedom of the country, not only for himself. I knew that the oppressor, now this are very important lines. I knew that the oppressor must be liberated just as surely as the oppressed. Now here in this paragraph, the author is telling about two types of people. One is the one who is the oppressor and one who is oppressed. You can see here, the two pictures are there. Both seems that they are in jail. You can see one another picture. The one is the oppressor and one is the oppressed. Both are having a negative feeling. So what Nelson Mandela is saying, a man who takes away another man's freedom is a prisoner of hatred. He is locked behind the bars of prejudice and narrow-mindedness. The person who oppresses others, okay, who rules on others, he himself is also having the feeling of hatred, which is a negative feeling. He is having a narrow-mindedness. And I am not truly free if I am taking away someone else's freedom just as surely as I am not free when my freedom is taken from me. The oppressed and the oppressor alike are robbed by their humanity. So here in this line, what he wants to say, that the person who is being oppressed, he is also having negative feeling because he have grudges for the oppressor, and he also wants to take a revenge. So what he says, that both this person, the oppressor and oppressed, both are under negative feeling. So both should be released. So through these lines, he wanted to say that the oppressor means the whites, they are also having a feeling of hatred, and on the other side, the oppressed, they are also having the feeling of revenge, which is against the humanity. So both should be set free. Both should be happy. And this can happen only and only if both live in harmony together. So this autobiographical piece gives the message of equality among mankind and the necessity of freedom for people. So through this chapter, or in these lines, the Nelson Mandela wants to say that there should be equality among mankind. People should live in harmony, and freedom is should be for every people. It is the necessity of human being. And these are few questions that have been asked in the exam. You can just go through it. What did being free mean to Mandela as a boy and a student? So when he was a boy, what was the meaning of freedom for him? And what was the meaning when he was a student? You can just pause the video and read the answer. Why is 10th May 1994 important for South Africa? Because the first democratic government was installed, and for the first time in the history of South Africa, a black became the president of South Africa. What was the dream of Nelson Mandela for the future of South Africa? So what was the dream? He wanted to make a country which will live in harmony, which will bondage the poverty, deprivation, sufferings, gender, and the discrimination. Why did Nelson Mandela say the oppressed and the oppressor alike are robbed by the humanity? Because through these lines, he wanted to say that the oppressor is the prisoner of hatred, while the oppressed has no confidence in humanity. So the oppressor is having the feeling of hatred, and the oppressed person, he doesn't have faith in humanity. So both should be liberated, both should be made free. How does Nelson Mandela define the meaning of courage and the brave man? So according to him, the meaning of courage is not the absence of fear, but the victory over it. And the meaning of brave man is, a brave man is not he who does not feel afraid, but he who conquers that fear. I hope, students, you would be able to understand the chapter well. If you like my video, please like, share, and subscribe. Thank you.